Father, we come in your great name because you've invited us to come. And we can just barge right in, Lord. We don't have to wait in line. We don't have to take a number. We don't have to make an appointment. You, Father, are so great and transient, Father, that we can't even imagine how that you're able to hear all of us at the same time, Father, without any confusion, without any separation. And Father, we thank you that you hear the cries of your people, that you invite us to bring every single need we have to you, every concern, every thought, anything, Lord. You want to walk with us in relationship through all of life. And Father, how sweet it is when you do walk with us, and we give you opportunity to rule and reign in our life, in our convictions, in our heart, in our actions. So we come, Lord, today like we do every Sunday, faithfully, Lord, to kneel down before you and ask you to speak into our hearts those things we don't know, those things we've forgotten, those things we've moved past, Lord, those things that need our attention. And so, Lord, we humble and we ask you, oh God of heaven, would you speak to our heart? Lord, as we listen, as we commit ourselves to focus and block out all the distracting things, Lord, and just listen for your voice, following your word in your Bible, Lord, as you speak, God, let us hear. Let your people hear, know, and understand. Father, change us, each and every one of us. Lord, all of us stand in need of that. None of us can say we've arrived. And Father, may we together grow in the likeness and the image of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We pray for those that are not here today, Lord, mindful of many of them in various places. We ask your
It blesses my heart beyond my ability to communicate. How much I love you and how much I love your desire to not hear the trifling, transient words of man, but have a heart to hear the word of the eternal God. We have had what I pray has been an amazing time through Paul's letter to the churches at Ephesus. We began our study in September of last year, and today we come to the last four verses of this amazing letter. If you have your New Testament, your Bible there, you may want to open to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 21. We have it here on the screen in the New King James Translation, if that's different than yours. Would you like to stand one more time? Stand. We'll honor the Lord by our standing, if you're able to stand. So Paul, in this great letter, begins in verse 21. "But that you also may know my affairs and how I am doing, Tychicus, a beloved brother and faithful minister in the Lord, will make all things known to you, whom I have sent to you for this very purpose, that you may know our affairs and that he may comfort your hearts. Peace to the brethren and love with faith from God and the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all those who love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity." Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. A study that maybe you've never attempted is a study comparing the endings of Paul's letters. How this apostle closed the letters that he wrote. Paul concludes the letter to Rome. You may remember, let me just refresh your memory of the last words of that letter. He wrote to the church at Rome, and he ends like a crescendo in music. He says, "Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery kept since the world began, but now made manifest, and by the prophetic scriptures made known to all nations, according to the commandment of the everlasting God for obedience to the faith, God alone wise, be glory through Jesus Christ forever. Amen." What an amazing crescendo, what an amazing way to conclude that great letter to the church at Rome. And so, I, like others, thought that Paul's thought reached its highest pinnacle in this letter, the letter to the church at Ephesus. I mean, it is special among all of the world's writings. In this letter, Paul descends from the rarefied air of us sitting with the Lord in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And he ends this letter with what seems like kind of an anticlimax. A personal note about a minor person named Tychicus. You know, if this letter was a movie today, Tychicus would not appear with the major characters or even the minor characters. More likely, he would be among the faceless, nameless people that we see in a film when it says extras. You may have had a friend or someone who's been an extra, one of the crowds at a movie. When you examine the books on Bible characters, you rarely will find a book that will even address Tychicus. Nevertheless, I would make the argument he's not to be discounted. On five different occasions in the correspondence of the New Testament, this man's name is mentioned. Now, if you or I had been mentioned by name in the New Testament, we would have thought that was one of the coolest things in all the world. Now, some of us have our first names there, right? But not the whole name, and we know that they weren't talking about us. But it would be a glorious thing if somehow we had made it into God's Word. There is enough about Tychicus and his character that is etched in fine enough detail and is both explicit and implicit that he is quite the edifying person. So let me just give you the bare facts about this man named Tychicus. He's Paul's mailman, if that's an easier way for you to remember it. Tychicus carried the letters that the Apostle Paul wrote. Yeah, a personal courier, if you will. He's mentioned for the first time in the book of Acts chapter 20 as one of those who went with Paul at the end of his third missionary journey when he had taken up that huge love offering from all of the non-Jewish churches, the Gentile churches, and the group of men who were trusted to take that most handsome offering to the church in Jerusalem and let them distribute it. So whatever we say about Tychicus, his stewardship, his personal management of affairs was of sterling quality so that he could be trusted to make sure that money that had been collected from so many churches over so long a period in Asia Minor would safely make its way to the church in Jerusalem. Now, I would tell you, church, there's a lot of people in church today who don't rise to that level. There are people in church today you might not trust with a plug nickel. Right? Sometimes character doesn't rise to the level of that kind of entrustment. We find Tychicus again after this mention in the book of Colossians, chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. And it's from those designations in Colossians and these here in Ephesians that the character of Tychicus takes on his identity. He's described with three terms. He's called a beloved brother. And since Paul didn't use the personal pronoun my brother, he seems to be stating a simple, well-known fact. Everyone knows that Tychicus is simply a beloved brother. He is a warm brother that we all have good feelings about and trust. But secondly, he is called a faithful minister in the Lord. That word for minister is the broadest word. It means any kind of service that we do for the Lord Jesus Christ. All of us, we know, are ministers. All of us have the privilege of serving the Lord Jesus Christ in so many ways that the Lord leads and guides us. He was trustworthy to carry out ministry. But then, in Colossians, he's called a fellow slave of the Apostle Paul. Paul had no issue with claiming this brother as a colleague under the same master. But other than those three designations, we have little else to give us personality. We know he could be trusted to give a good report about the Apostle Paul and about the church where Paul may have been at that time. We know he could be trusted to carry the parchments that Paul had given him, the original autographs. We read that when he was sent by Paul to give information about Paul, and his condition. Remember, Paul's in jail as he's writing this. First century jails are something you have trouble imagining, and he is bringing word on how he is truly doing. You notice Paul doesn't take up any parchment to give his own status or situation. He leaves that to Tychicus. Now, everything else we know from Tychicus is from two other New Testament references. In the book of Titus, Paul mentions that he may send Tychicus as a replacement for Pastor Titus on the island of Crete. We don't know if that happened or not, but Paul was contemplating that. That gives us a lot of insight into Tychicus. That means, above everything else, that Tychicus was capable of being given a difficult responsibility that demanded diplomacy. Crete, if you don't recall Crete, that island of Crete, you know, people were called Cretans when you wanted to insult someone. They're like a Cretan. It was not a compliment, a very tough, hard place to do ministry. And Tychicus, in Paul's mind, was capable of leading a tough place like that. And then we read in 2 Timothy 4:12, he said, Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. Now, some scholars, I'm not saying it's true or not, but some scholars believe that Tychicus was sent to Ephesus for the purpose of relieving Timothy, who's pastoring in Ephesus. Because in the Roman letter, remember, Paul told Timothy, come before winter. There was an urgency as Paul was, I think, anticipating his soon coming death, that he wanted his son in the faith. He wanted Timothy to be with him there. Now, the only thing, other thing we know about Tychicus by implication is that when he took this Ephesian letter and this Colossian letter to the churches, Onesimus, that runaway slave, was taken also by Tychicus to be delivered to his master Philemon. You remember Onesimus, the runaway slave? Paul found him in Rome, led him to the Lord, and now is sending him back to his master to finish serving his master. Well, Tychicus had the job of taking Onesimus back and bringing that letter of what Paul says to Philemon by way of his recommendation. So that means that Tychicus had some tactfulness, he had some discretion, he had a capacity to handle some touchy situations, tough relationships, and that's all we know. That's kind of the bare facts about this fellow that shows up in Paul's letters. You know, as we look at this New Testament, people appear in different ways. And one preacher talked about it in terms of some characters in the New Testament are like the stars. They are always there. They're just perennial personalities in the New Testament. But then there's also others like Apollos in the book of Acts, and he's kind of like a meteor that just kind of flies through. We see him burn up, and then he goes away. And then there's characters in the New Testament like comets. They circle through. We see them once, and then later on, we see them again later on in the story. Tychicus is one of those we see again and again. And yet from these meager lessons, I think we can learn. I think God would have us to learn some things that will encourage us from the life of Tychicus. The first thing I think God would have us to see is that Tychicus' greatest attribute was that he manifested the greatness of dependability. Tychicus demonstrated the greatness of dependability. In each of the five instances he is mentioned there is one characteristic. He was always a person who was sent. He was always the guy Paul tapped to send. In fact, you could summarize, I think, Tychicus' life by saying, having been sent, he went. Having been sent, he went. Now, that may not rock your world, or should it? That's not the least thing that you can say about a servant of Jesus Christ. He manifested the greatness of an anonymous and faithful dependability. Let's just look briefly at just a couple of other of the characters that are in the circle of the Apostle Paul. Think about Barnabas, the one who brought a Saul of Tarsus into the family of God, helped introduce him to the apostles. He divided ministry with Paul. They had a contention, and they agreed to go separate ways. Two mission trips instead of one, and Barnabas and Paul separate and go other ways. Tychicus stayed with Paul, we know of, for approximately 10 years. A bright person like Apollos even had unwittingly caused Paul some problems in the church of Corinth. Apollos was so silver-tongued, he was so well-trained in rhetoric, he was such a great speaker that when they compared him to Paul, Paul didn't fare too well. But Paul was rather rude in his delivery of a message than was Apollos. Paul was contrasted with him and not favorably. Tychicus was dependable. He was there. And then you think about Demas, who showed such great signs of promise. There are scholars who think Demas probably was a secretary or an amanuensis, the guy who writes down what the apostle dictates and served Paul. But then Demas forsook Paul because he loved the world instead. He gave up being Paul's secretary, perhaps, so that he could pursue the things of the world. But Tychicus, with his faceless, nameless dependability, was still there. He was still there plugging away while all of this is happening around Paul and through those characters who surrounded him. Now, let me just tell you that if the magic tooth fairy of churches were to come to me and say, "Pastor Mark, I'm going to give you a chance to create the church you want to create. And here are your choices. You can have people who are absolutely intellectually brilliant and dazzling in their ability to grasp. Or you can have talented people with all kinds of skills. Or you can have the energy of the youthful congregation. But in those three choices, you will have people who are unpredictable, who are fickle, and who are capricious. You may have them, or maybe they will leave. Or on the other hand, I offer you a group of colorless, nondescript, indistinguishable people lacking a great deal in charm or ability, but they will undoubtedly be dependable and they'll be steadfast." Church, I'm painting that picture because you know there'd be no hesitation for me. There's a greatness about dependability in the service of Christ. Tychicus was steadfast and he was dependable. Paul had no doubt that if Demas was going to leave, if Epaphroditus had to be sent somewhere else, if Barnabas was going to take a different mission trip going another way, there was going to be one in that circle who would be there. Tychicus would be there perhaps when no one else was around. You can serve up Tychicus' life by saying, having been sent, he went. But there's more than that. The second thing I think God would have us to see is that he was enabled rather than embittered by his ordinariness. He was enabled rather than embittered by his ordinary. Tychicus could not avoid recognizing the difference between him and the fellows that kept company with Paul. Tychicus was not standing with the Apollos in rhetoric. He was not standing with Barnabas in the social standing and popularity of that man. He was not in league with Dr. Luke, who was most intimate with the apostle, keeping him moving, keeping him alive, keeping him bandaged, keeping him moving forward, always there, attending to his need. He wasn't like Silas. Silas joined when Barnabas left. So Tychicus likely never received the title like, say, Timothy got. My beloved son in the Lord. That wasn't said of Tychicus. It wasn't true of him. He had the diplomacy, maybe like Titus. And yet the fact that Tychicus would work away in his ordinariness didn't embitter him. He was not jealous of others' giftedness. The truth is, it became his great enablement in life that he had service to God, and it's as the mailman to the Apostle Paul, a guy who ministered to those churches like none other. And in that ordinariness, he felt special. It enabled him rather than embitter him that he couldn't do something else that he might have wanted to do. There are those church who plod their way to unadorned success, who made more out of what God gave them than many a blazing genius for whom things come so very easily. I think God's talking about a lot of people in this room. Unadorned success, Tychicus was one of those plotters in the kingdom who was not embittered that he wasn't a star in Paul's close circle. And he capitalized on that very fact. He, in effect, said, I'll turn the ordinary into the extraordinary. I'll be the best personal courier Paul could have ever asked for. Those letters will get everywhere they're supposed to get. And they will be, I will return to do it again and again, as difficult as it may be, as risky as it may be. And he consecrated his just ordinary powers and made himself indispensable to the Apostle Paul. And I think in so doing that, he joined the ranks of a luminary like Andrew. Andrew, remember, first found Jesus, and then he went and found his brother Peter. And now Andrew kind of disappears in the apostle group, and it's now the Peter show. He's the head of the class. He's the one talking. He's the one getting all the attention, right? Andrew, we don't hear much about. He brings Peter, and Peter kind of takes things over, and Andrew, we don't hear too much about. He seems to take this minor role throughout the New Testament. But then we read also that he went and found a little boy that had 5 fish and 2 loaves. Andrew found him and brought him to Jesus. Something Andrew had done before successfully and did again. And before the Lord will be crucified, Andrew will bring the Greeks, the non-Jewish people who came, who heard of Jesus, and came and wanted to hear from this master, and they just had to. You know, Jesus, generally speaking, said, I'm sent to the house of Israel. I'm not here for the whole world now in this moment. I'm sent to my own. And so he comes to his own, and yet Andrew had a way in relation with Christ, and he brings these Greeks at a very critical time in the life and ministry of Christ, and Andrew introduces them. And the record goes quiet. Who were those men? And what did they do? And what happened as a result of all of that? You know, most people in this auditorium, I would probably venture to say 99% of the people in this auditorium have never heard of a man named James Spurgeon. He doesn't have a college named after him, and he doesn't have any statues made of him, and there's no volumes of his sermons that you can go and buy. There's no tombstone of any particular significance that marks his grave, as does his brother Charles Haddon Spurgeon. James was Charles's little brother, and he was the associate pastor of the Metropolitan Tabernacle. And he saved his brother's tush time and time and time again, working as an associate pastor in administrative things of which his brother had no gifts. He saved the church. He saved the church's finances. He did a number of things for which most people have no earthly idea. Tychicus was one of those two who were able to turn the ordinary into the extraordinary by taking common gifts, making them indispensable to the kingdom of God because of the sheer force of his faithfulness. How did he make the ordinary into the extraordinary? Well, I think we see, first of all, in his being a courier, he carried that circular letter to the churches in Ephesus. He went to Colossae. He went and found Philemon, brought Onesimus there. In Paul's day, you know, there was no mail service. You could find somebody and pay them or whatever, force them. They could take a letter to somebody, and hopefully it got there. But the reality is, in the first century world, that was far from certain. These precious New Testament letters that we take so for granted and have reproduced so voluminously, you know, were questionable whether they would arrive at their proper station, their proper place. The most priceless ministry that Tychicus accomplished that we know of was that he was the man who carried the very letter that you and I have studied since last September. But probably more than that, I think Tychicus read it to the congregation. Education was not in the first century what it is in the 21st century. Tychicus had the education, and as Paul, and whatever role Tychicus may have had, even the writing of it, Paul's letters are heavy They are deep. Even when read, you have to read them again and again in some cases because of the depth of this man's spirituality, the illumination from God's Holy Spirit. You just don't read it and know it. It requires that over and over again, and then probably standing and answering questions. What does Paul mean by this? Explain this to us. We don't know what he means by this. He read it to the church. You know, one commentator made the observation. He plotted out the route that the Apostle Paul would have taken. I'm sorry, that Tychicus would have taken from the Apostle Paul from Rome all the way to Ephesus and Colossae. And they said it's easy to map out, but when you travel it, it's very difficult. You're going from community to community, from place to place, and it wasn't the safest thing to do. Can you imagine if we could enter a time warp? Tychicus is making his way all the way across Asia Minor to Ephesus. Can you imagine if somehow we could just kind of beam in on him, time warp in on him, and be waiting there on the road as he comes around the corner? And say, Tychicus, do you have any idea of what you're a part of? Can you imagine in your wildest imaginations that those little scrubby parchments that you're carrying and you're reading will be the subject of God's people world over until He comes again? Men will give their lives in the study of your letters, of what God has told you and what you share with us. You, Tychicus, are carrying. Well, or maybe another way to put it. What if we go that enter that same time warp, except you show up in Tychicus's place? You're standing around with all the luminaries around Paul. You're standing around with these guys, you know, like Silas and Demas and Aristarchus and Artemis and Titus. Y'all are all standing there. And the Apostle Paul looks at you and says, here, I want you to take this to Ephesus and to Colossae and read it for them and tell them how I'm doing. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine being a part of transmitting this one letter? That one copy is all there is in the world. And it's a dangerous world. And you have the responsibility of safely getting it there. I tell you, we would be staggered to know, church, we're holding in our hand the autograph of what would be considered the most precious correspondence in world history. You know, would we tremble with excitement? You know, Tychicus didn't know that. Tychicus wasn't in any time warp. He was living in the first century Asia Minor, serving God by serving the Apostle Paul. He was just like us. He didn't know how often the light of the eternal bathes the most common things we do. Thank you. Let's let that sink in. Let me say it again. He didn't know how often the light of the eternal bathes the most common things we do. This is a closed canon. God has written it. He closed it. It's what we need to live life until He comes back again. But the book of Acts, Dr. Luke made it clear, these are the things that the Holy Spirit began to do. And so He will do until the Lord comes. The rest of this book and the history of these people and of the relationship between God and His people is being written every day and every year, every continent, the world over, as God begins to bring this thing to consummation. It's what He does. Let me give you a few examples. Let me try to illustrate what I'm saying. Because I'd have preferred somebody more than just Dawn, although I think it was Dawn, staying with me on this. This is where we live, brothers and sisters. You don't think of yourself as being Paul or Apollos. You never once consider yourself to be that. And shame on you for thinking such. Mordecai Ham. Ring a bell for anyone? Mordecai was a very peculiar back road evangelist with some rather bizarre beliefs about the Bible. But he was preaching one night when a 16-year-old William Franklin Graham stepped forward and confessed his faith in Jesus Christ. And what about that Methodist layman, actually primitive Methodist layman, who was preaching on a snowy day in a chapel in Colchester, England, only because the real preacher didn't show up. And there in his congregation of 16 people, he preached. And the 16-year-old boy who stepped forward to receive Christ in his heart, he had no idea that this young teenager, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, would rock the English-speaking world. And then what about those Moravians that were singing on board the ship in a storm in the Atlantic because they were scared and witless and were singing songs of the faith? They had no earthly idea that within earshot of them was a young man by the name of John Wesley who fell under conviction listening to them sing and would come to serve their Lord and their God. All around us, there is incalculable capacity, unknowingly, to touch that which one day belonged to the ages. You do not know what God has done through your efforts, through your faithfulness, through your obedience. You do not, cannot, are incapable. It's an absolute work of impossibility for you to know what God has done through your life. Be it big or be it small, be it vocal or be it nonverbal, you have no idea. What you do have is opportunity. What you do have is life, still time left. What if that next great thing, what if the greatest thing still remains in front of you? What if God wants you to move and shake the world for Christ? What if you're going to be one of those? All of us, truthfully, you don't know what the Lord Jesus Christ will hand you, how you will touch it, and how you will touch the forever. I'll make one last observation. Don't mistake all of this as a matter of personal loyalty to Paul. Tychicus, I assure you, endured because of his ultimate motivation. That's what Paul says. He said, in the Lord. It was in the Lord that Tychicus did what he did. Tychicus, beloved brother and faithful minister, in the Lord. He wasn't Paul's lackey. He wasn't his slave. He wasn't his gopher. He was a person in the Lord. I'm sure Tychicus had a loyalty to Paul. You know, Paul, Apostle Paul, had a very polarizing effect on people, right? You either liked him or you would prefer to see him dead. There was not a lot of gray area in this man's life. You embraced him or you hated him. That seems to be his effect on almost everybody. You were either for him or you were against him. And when his personality fastened on a person, it's pretty rare for that person to escape. But that's not the motivation for Tychicus's dependability. Tychicus had been with Paul long enough, church, to see his feet of clay, and to know his weakness, and to acknowledge his humanity. When you stay close with someone through thick and thin, and hard and good times, you recognize they're human, like everybody else. If there's any star-fixed gaze in Tychicus' eyes over Paul, which I can't fathom how there would be, but if there were, I assure you it did not last. It was the vital union he had with Jesus Christ. The letter comes to a close just as it opened, in Christ Jesus. Tychicus was a man whose vital union with Christ made him to be the man who turned the ordinary into the extraordinary, who was enabled rather than embittered by that fact, and whose very character speaks of dependability, without which there is no church and there is no kingdom. Tychicus encourages me. You know why? Because there's far more of us Tychicuses than there are Apostle Pauls. I want to encourage you, and I don't want to embarrass anybody, so I'm going to leave names out. And I hope I can get through this. A card that showed up in my mailbox this morning. Dear Pastor Mark, Thank you for opening your heart and doors beyond your flock and reaching out to the community. It was the simple invitation on your marquee for Vacation Bible School 3 years ago that brought us in. Your church greeted us with smiles and welcomed us the moment we walked in. Your Vacation Bible School was so well put together. Everyone was invested with a joyful heart. We felt safe and confident to return. Our daughters have loved it so much. They invited many of their classmates whose families do not know Jesus. We are overjoyed to tell you two of their friends accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior. One of the friends' grandmother, who is her guardian, said she left the church years and years ago. She attended family night. She heard the kids' music. It touched her heart, and she felt the Spirit calling her back. Thank you for your investment in God's kingdom. I wanted to share with you the fruit your church is bearing. May God continue the work of your hands with much appreciation. And the footnote says, I wish I could thank all who were involved. Keep at it, church. Keep at it. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, how we love you. And we know, God, intuitively, that each and everything we do that we believe is obeying you and doing what you want us to do makes a difference. Though we rarely get to see any kind of immediate thing, immediate fruit, we know fruit doesn't grow and ripen all in the same moment. But Father, we need these words. We need to hear these words and what words they were for me this morning. And God, I pray that in my reading of these words with your great letter from the Apostle Paul will steal our hearts and free us, O God, to not be tight with our church's ministry. But that, God, we will seek and find you in all kinds of places. That, God, we will try everything possible to reach out and locate a new child, a new adult, a new senior adult, to share with them, to love them, to minister to them in ways that are possible. That God, either in this life or before they leave, they'll come to find you. And Lord, today, if there's any one of these who've come to a saving relationship with you, oh Lord, we pray they'll make it known. They'll not wait years and years or even weeks and weeks. But God, if they pledged faith in you, they need to be baptized, Father. They need to be biblically baptized. Make it known that they've trusted Christ for salvation. Other families, Lord, who walk with you, but Father, they don't have a church home right now. They're not attending a place where they were last called home. And God, it's imperative that we have family, spiritual family. And the way we do that legitimately is by signing on the dotted line, by saying, I think God wants me here. And I want to be part of people like this to live my life and to put my family in, that we might grow together in whatever time, God, you give us. I want to be around your people, positive and joyous, willing to reach out and make a difference. Father, I pray you'll add to this church as is fitting to you. And I pray, God, it'll be a burden on our hearts, every vacant seat in this building, Lord. Every time we air condition it, clean it, and prepare it, and that seat goes empty, it seems to say bad stewardship. There's a place someone else could hear the eternal word of God, and we're missing them. We've not invited them. We've not tried to bring them with us. And Father, eternity suffers because of it. Father, touch our hearts, encourage our hearts, that we might be faithful and dependable all the way to the end. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'd like to stand with me, Derek's going to lead us. You stand, sing, pray. You're welcome to come. If I can help, I'm down here.